Welcome to the last part of the discussion on accounting for corporate liquidation and reorganization. So let us proceed by illustrating more of the sum items. So under illustration, we have ended on these items, how do we squeeze items using the reconstruction of information, or limited lang yung bibigay sa yung information. So let us look at illustration 1, recovery of claims by order of priority. So ABC company, as a statement of affairs, indicate that unsecured creditors without priority with total claims of 180,000 can expect to recover 72,000 if all the assets were sold. Among the creditors of ABC are the following. So merong government, XYZ Bank, Alpha Financing Company, and Mr. Bombay. So the requirement is to compute how much is the expected recovery of each of the creditors listed above. So, tingnan lang muna natin yung mga creditors. One is the government. Taxes payable, 100,000. Inclusive of 20,000 assessments and surcharges. Itong government, dahil yan ay taxes payable, this is considered as unsecured creditors with priority. So, prioritize yan. XYZ Bank, loan payable, 1 million. And accrued interest of 50,000 backed by collateral with realizable value of 1,200,000. So, ibig sabihin yan ay fully secured creditor. Kasi, liabilities, 1 million, tsaka 50, 1,050,000. Then, ang naka-pledge sa kanya ay 1.2 million. So, fully secured si XYZ Bank. So, i-classify natin. Si Alpha Financing Company is, may utang tayo dyan na 800,000. Then, ang collateral natin ay 500,000 lang. So, this is a partially secured creditor. Mr. Bombay is loan payable of, may utang tayong 250,000 and accrued interest of 50. So, 300,000. 250 plus 50 is 300,000 ang total liability natin kay Mr. Bombay, and wala tayong collateral. So, this is an unsecured creditor without priority. So, ang tinatanong is the recovery, expected recovery for each. Okay, for each. So, wala tayong problem kay government because this is a priority. Normally, yaan ay 100,000. Si XYZ, 100% itong kay government. Inclusive of 20,000 assessments and surcharges, yes. Kasama pa rin yan doon sa 100,000. Kasi kasama yan sa priority. Yung XYZ Bank, 1,050,000. 1,050,000 ay fully secured, so 100% niyan. Etong kay Alpha and Mr. Bombay, ang magkakaroon tayo ng computation because may portions na unsecured. So, kailangan natin compute-in yung recovery percentage natin. So, how do we compute for recovery percentage? Sa discussion videos natin, di ba? Net free assets divided by the unsecured creditors without priority, yung total. Magkano ba ang total unsecured creditors without priority? Okay, tingnan mo yung items doon sa taas. ABC Company's Statement of Affairs indicates that unsecured creditors without priority with total claims of 180,000 can expect to recover 72,000 if all the assets were sold. So, among the creditors, tsaka niya binigay. So, ibig sabihin, based on this problem, binigay na niya kaagad yung total unsecured creditors without priority. Ang total daw ay 180, at kung 180 daw ang kumbaga nagbigay siya ng situation on which ito yung ratio and proportion. 180,000, kung ang total claim ay 180, ang pwede niya lang ma-recover ay 72,000. So, ibig sabihin, 72 divided by 180 is 40%. So, that is the recovery percentage, 40%. So, how do we compute? Let's look at the tabulation. So, for government, 100,000 dahil 100%. For XYZ, 1,050,000 dahil 100%. Kay Alpha Financing, ang utang dyan ay 800,000. 500,000 lang ang secured. So, 500,000 plus 300,000 times 40%. Kumbaga, yung 40% lang ng 300,000 ang kayang i-recover. So, that the answer is 620,000. So, kay Mr. Bombay, magkano ang total utang natin dyan? 300,000 times 40% is 120,000. So, this is the answers. Yung expected recovery for each type of creditor. Let's proceed with illustration 2, recovery of claims. ABC Company is undergoing liquidation. Information on ABC Company's assets and liabilities is shown below. So, binigyan ka ng assets dyan for fully secured, partially secured, and then free assets at their book and realizable values. Liabilities given yung with priority, fully secured, partially secured, and unsecured creditors without priority. So, the requirements are, if the assets are sold at realizable values, how much cash is available to pay unsecured creditors without priority? B, yung estimated recovery ng unsecured creditors without priority. So, C, how the deficiency to unsecured creditors. And D, how much can each class of creditors expect to recover from their claims. So, let's proceed with item A. If the assets are sold at realizable value, so itong 292 na benta ng 312, ganun siya. How much cash is available to pay unsecured creditors without priority? How much cash is available to pay unsecured creditors without priority? So, let us look at how can we compute for this. So, tingnan mo, ang realizable value ng assets mo ay 312,000. Ang unsecured creditors mo ay 72,000. Ang fully secured mo, 96,000. Then, the realizable value of assets pledged to partially secured creditors ay 48,000. So, what's the answer for item A? 96,000. Kasi, yung total na 312, ibawas mo muna yung with priority, ibawas mo yung fully secured, and then yung pledge dun sa partially secured. So, the answer for item A is 96,000. Diba? With priority, secured, and then partially secured creditors. So, yan ang 96,000 ang available sa mga unsecured creditors na without priority. Included dyan yung partially secured creditors yung excess doon. For item B, what is the estimated recovery percentage of unsecured creditors? How do we compute for the percentage? The net free assets na na-compute mo kanina, 96,000 divided by the total unsecured liabilities without priority. So, ang numerator mo, 96,000, kasi na-compute na natin yan. Yan yung free na for distribution for unsecured creditors without priority. Ngayon, magkano ba ang liabilities without priority mo dyan? Merong nakalagay dyan, 108,000. Ito na ba yon? Hindi pa. Dahil, dito sa partially secured creditors, meron ditong hindi mababayaran. So, isasama mo yan dyan sa computation ng unsecured liabilities without priority. So, magkano yung hindi mababayaran? Ang sabi kanina, 48,000 lang ang kayang bayaran. So, 60,000 ang total ng partially secured minus 48. So, merong natirang 12 na unsecured creditors without priority. So, 108,000 na without priority plus 12,000 na deficiency dun sa assets na pledged to partially secured is 120 na ngayon ang total unsecured liability without priority. So, lagi mong tatandaan na yung unsecured liability without priority ay manggagaling sa dalawang items. One is yung naka-indicate mismo na without priority, and two, yung galing doon sa partially secured creditors. Okay? So, 96,000 divided by 120,000 is 80%. So, the answer for B is 80% ang recovery percentage. For item C, how much is the total estimated deficiency to unsecured creditors. So, magkano ang estimated deficiency sa unsecured creditors? For you to easily analyze this, dahil na-compute mo naman na yung unsecured liabilities without priority na 120,000, multiply mo lang yan sa 20%. Diba sabi, 80% ay marerecover. Kasi yun yung recovery percentage. Ibig sabihin, yung 20%, that is your deficiency percentage. So, 120 times 20%. So, I recommend you to use this alternative solution. Yung 120 times 20%, 24,000. But there are other solutions. Pwedeng yung net free assets minus the total unsecured liabilities without priority, 24. Pwede yun. Pwede rin the total assets at realizable value, 312, minus the total liabilities at realizable value na 336, that is 24. Pero para sa akin, mas madali maintindihan if 120 times 20% is 24,000. Okay, requirement D, recovery by each class of creditor. So, i-identify lang natin. So, yung with priority, 100% yun, 72,000. Yung fully secured, 100% yun, 96,000. Yung partially secured, 60,000 yung total nun, 48,000 plus 12,000 times 80%. So, that is 57,600. So, yung unsecured liabilities without priority, 80% nun, 86,400. So, total 312,000. Yun yung total assets mo. Diba? Yung realizable value. Yung pagbebentahan ng assets, 312. So, ngayon, distribute na natin siya based on the recovery percentage. Okay? How about kung ang tinatanong is the recovery percentage for your shareholders? So, let us look at this problem. Binigyan ka ng gain on realization of assets, loss on realization of assets, additional assets realized during liquidation, additional liability settled during liquidation, share capital at original book value. So, kung ano yung nasa books carrying amount, 700,000. Retained earnings, deficit at original book value, 300,000. So, ito ay deficit daw. This is a negative. This is a retained deficit. Requirements to compute for the recovery percentage of the shareholders based on the book value of the shareholders' equity. So, how do we compute for recovery percentage? Diba? Ang formula is the net free assets divided by the total unsecured liabilities without priority. This is a percentage for the shareholders. This is a recovery percentage for shareholders. So, papalitan mo lang yung denominator mo ng book value ng yung share capital para makompute mo yung recovery percentage sa bawat isang shareholder. Okay. Based on the given information, kailangan muna nating makompute yung ating net free assets. So, based on the given information, makukompute ba natin ang net free assets? So, meron ba binigay na net free assets? Ang binigay lang dyan, mga gains and losses on realization, mga additional assets realized. Asan ang beginning balance natin? So, based on the information, wala. So, we need to reconstruct the information dyan. Ang binigay lang sa'yo ay share capital and retained earnings. So, using the basic equation, naka-asset is equal to liabilities plus equity, we know that the share capital and the retained earnings deficit is part of equity. So, share capital, 700,000. Dahil i-add mo yung earnings, pero dahil deficit yan, ibawas mo. 700 minus 300,000 is 400,000 ang yung equity. May binigay bang info related to liabilities? Ang binigay lang, additional liability. So, hindi yan yung beginning. So, paano gagawin natin dyan? So, we assume that because the equation is asset is equal to liabilities plus equity, the assets minus the liabilities at the beginning is equal to 400,000. So, ito yung squeeze items dyan. Diba? The assets minus liabilities is 400,000 kasi dapat equal yan at book values at the beginning of the transaction. So, 400,000, 400,000 for equity and for assets minus liabilities. Sir, paano po yan? Yan na po bang gagamitin kong information for me to arrive at the net free assets? The answer is, etong 400 na bang gagamitin ko? To arrive at the beginning, Yes. Because, di ba, sa order of priority, uunahing bayaran yung outside creditor. So, we assume here that the part of the assets have been used to pay for the outside liabilities or outside creditors. So, assets less liabilities at book value will be the starting figure, 400,000. Lahat ng gain and losses, additional assets, ay i-add at i-deduct natin dito. So, assets less liabilities, 400,000, plus gain on realization, 180, minus losses, 320, plus assets, additional assets realized during the liquidation, 50, minus yung additional liabilities na sinettle during liquidation, minus 30,000 ka dyan. So, this will be your net free assets available for shareholders, 280,000. You divide it with the book value of the shareholders' equity, which is, magkano ba ang book value ng shareholders' equity? 400,000, computed as 700 minus 300,000. So, 280 minus, divided by 400,000 is 70%. So, this is your recovery percentage for the shareholders. Okay? Let us look at illustration 4. So, the recovery of shareholders' claims. So, ABC company owns 80% of XYZ, a liquidating entity. ABC has an unsecured receivable of 1 million from XYZ and an investment in subsidiary of 5 million. XYZ's statement of affairs shows 10% recovery for outside. So, kapag outside daw, I know, 100% recovery for outside. Pag outside creditor, mababayaran in full. Pag inside creditor, 20% lang ang kayang bayaran ng XYZ company. So, the requirements are how much can ABC expect to recover from receivable, from its receivable, and from its investment under item B. So, for you to analyze this, you have to identify the ABC, in what capacity does ABC collects? So, in what capacity ba siya nangongolekta? So, for item A, ang sabi, kasi si ABC, meron siyang ownership ng 80% kay XYZ at meron ay, at siya ay at the same time ay merong utang din sa kanya ang XYZ at an unsecured receivable na 1 million. So, doon daw sa 1 million under item A, magkano ang ikmakokollect ni ABC? Okay. You have to analyze whether ABC is an outside or an inside creditor. So, based on the information, ABC company is an inside creditor dahil siya ay may ownership sa XYZ. So, therefore, 20% lang ang pwede niyang makolekta sa kanyang receivable based on the information. So, 1 million times 20% is 200,000. Okay, that's the answer for item A. For item B, how much can ABC expect to recover from its investment? So, this is an investment. So, kumbaga, since ABC company is an owner, ang tinatanong na dito is kung magkano makukuha niya doon sa ownership capital niya sa XYZ Incorporated. Based on the information, the answer should be zero. Because, diba, sa order of priority, ang number one is the outside creditor. Number two is the inside creditors. And number three is the owner's capital. Since, based on the information, 20% lang ang pwedeng, ang marerecover ng inside creditors. Dahil 20% lang yan, hindi pwedeng maunang bigyan yung owner's capital because the investment in subsidiary is considered as an owner's capital in the corporation. So, hindi pwede dahil 20% lang ang kayang bayaran sa inside creditor, dapat yung owner's capital wala na yung marireceive. Kasi, dapat mag 100% muna yung outside and inside creditors bago ka magbigay sa yung owner's capital. So, the answer for item B is zero or none. The explanation is, since inside liabilities are not paid in full, none is paid for the owner's equity claims. Okay. Okay, let's take a look at illustration 5, the errors. So ABC Company has voluntarily filed a petition for bankruptcy. ABC's inexperienced accountant determined that the expected recovery percentage of unsecured creditors without priority is at 20%. The unsecured creditors have refuted this and demanded an audit of the accountant's computations. The following info was determined in the accountant's working papers. So, hindi matanggap ng unsecured creditors na 20% lang ang recovery percentage nila. Kaya nag-demand sila ng audit on the accountant's working papers. So, these are the items revealed. So, assets and liabilities, naka-identify dyan. Then, in-identify din yung book value, 1 million were sold for 940. A portion of the proceeds were used to settle fully secured of 540 and partially secured liabilities of 370. So, kung titingnan mo dito, a portion settle 540 lang pala yung naibayad sa fully secured creditors and 900,000 yung utang doon. So, ibig sabihin, hindi talaga fully secured yun. Parang partially siya. Ito namang partially secured na 520 ang nabayad 370. Okay? The remaining unsold assets, okay, ito yung natira. So, further investigations, meron daw estimated liquidation expenses amounting to 40. Hindi siya na-record. At itong additional unsecured liability without priority of 50 should be accrued or should be recorded. So, the requirement is to compute for the correct estimated recovery percentage. So, we assume here that the 20% recovery percentage initially computed by the accountant is erroneous. Okay, let's take a look. Ano itong sinasabing error? The liabilities described in the accountant's working paper as fully are actually only partially. Okay, ito yung napansin natin kanina. Kasi 540 yung binayad. Pero, 900 yung utang. Okay. Also, the related assets are pledged to partially secured, not to fully secured. Okay? So, hindi lang siya. Kumbaga, pinagbentahan kasi nitong 940 ay ibinayad kay fully secured daw at partially secured. So, ibig sabihin, hindi lang siya talaga naka-pledge sa iisang type of creditor. Okay. So how do we ang tinatanong dito is the recovery percentage. So we should compute for the net free assets divided by the total unsecured creditors without priority. So we have to identify first kung magkano yung total net free assets. Okay. Let us analyze I think we have to first analyze yung nabentang assets. Yung nabentang assets ay 940,000. Amount paid out of the proceeds. Okay, how can we analyze this? Diba, the computation on net free assets is the total assets mo na na-realize, yung magkano yung nabenta, then, diba, ibibigay mo muna yun sa with priority, sa fully secured, at saka sa partially secured creditors. Okay, i-analyze muna natin yung error na napansin natin kanina. Okay, yung fully secured creditor, ang sabi dyan ay, kasi itong 260, okay na yan eh. Madali lang natin ibabawas. Itong fully secured creditors natin, 900,000, di ba? Nabayaran siya ng 540,000 based on this additional information. So, may utang pa tayo na 360,000 sa kanya. Okay? Sa partially secured, ang utang 520, nabayaran siya ng 370. Then, ang liabilities pa na natitira, 150,000. Okay. So, ito pa yung natitirang utang natin kay fully and partially secured. Actually, hindi nga ito fully kasi dapat yan total, wala nang matitirang liabilities dyan. So, kasi nga erroneous yung analysis ng accountant here. So, meron daw remaining unsold assets for the following creditor. So assets pledged to fully, assets pledged to partially, so all other assets. So meron pa palang natira. So realizable value of assets na pwede pa nating ipang bayad doon sa fully secured, doon sa tinawag niyang fully pero hindi naman talaga, 320,000 daw, and kay partially 140. So kay dito kulang pa rin. Unsecured, may unsecured portion pa rin dito sa fully. 'Di ba? Ang parang mali. May unsecured portion pero sa fully. So dahil mali nga yung illustration, this we are dealing with errors. So may 40,000 unsecured portion pa doon sa allegedly ay fully secured, okay? Sa partially secured, meron pa ring 10,000 unsecured portion. So ang total deficiency sa lahat ng pledged na assets ay 50,000. So meron pa tayong kulang, may deficiency pa tayo. Kulang pa yung assets natin para doon sa fully, sa allegedly fully at partially secured creditors. 50,000 'yun. Okay. Let's now analyze the net free assets. The amount na napagbentahan, 940,000. 940,000 yung napagbentahan. Magkano o yung ibinayad na natin, naibayad na natin? 540 tsaka 370. Ito yon. So, that the total is 910,000. Okay? Then, i-add natin yung realizable value of remaining assets. Magkano ba ang remaining assets na naka-indicate? 320, 140, and 515. That is 975. So, these are the total assets at realizable values. Minus, ibawas natin yung natira pa dito. Yung 360 at saka 150. Okay? Let's look. Okay, wait lang. 300. Okay, we are computing for amount paid less a partially secured creditor. So, ito na yung realizable value natin, di ba? Yung realizable value ng ating assets, less natin itong ipabayad natin. Yung 320 and 140, kasi ito yung ibabayad pa natin. Additional doon sa allegedly fully at partially, total non 460. So, kung ibabawas pa natin yun, 1,005,000 minus 320 minus 140, that is 545,000 na lang ang total free assets. Okay? 545 na lang ang total free assets. Ano pa yung hindi natin na-consider? Fully, partially, tsaka unsecured creditors with priority, 260. 260, unsecured creditors with priority. Meron pa bang ibang unsecured creditors with priority dito? Estimated liquidation expenses. Ito, this is unsecured creditor with priority, yung 40,000. Itong unsecured liability without, ito hindi, without to eh. So, 260 plus 40 is 300,000. So, 545 minus 300 is 245,000 ang net free asset. So, ito na ang numerator mo, 245. So, doon naman tayo ngayon sa unsecured liab without priority. So, magkano ba ang unsecured liab without priority? Ang sabi dito, 440 plus... Ito, yung itong additional unsecured liab without priority daw na 50. 440 plus 50 is 490,000, okay? 490,000, 'di ba? Ang sabi ko dati, dalawang component ang pinanggagalingan ng unsecured liab without priority. One is yung mismong naka-identify na without priority at pangalawa, yung galing dun sa deficiency sa partially secured. Eh, di ba ito yung deficiency sa partially secured creditors, yung 50,000 na yan. Okay? So, i-add pa natin yan. So, 50. So, total, unsecured liab without priority is 540. So, yun ang denominator mo. 245 divided by 540 is 45.37%. So, that is your recovery percentage for unsecured creditors without priority. Di ba? Ang haba ng procedure for you to compute for the recovery percentage. And when you reach the review school and you are reviewing for the board exam, it will be a tedious process kasi minsan mas maraming items pa yung naka-indicate. Mas maraming assets, non-cash assets ang naka-indicate, mas maraming liabilities ang naka-indicate for you to finally compute for your recovery percentage. So, isang mali mo lang on the analysis, pwedeng magkamali yung final answer mo dyan. But the logic here is to stick on the basics. You have to familiarize yourself on how you compute for this. So, pag nakita mong recovery percentage, it is easy for you to identify that it is net free assets divided by unsecured liabilities without priority. At alam ko kapag net free assets, this is the assets realized minus unsecured liabilities with priority, fully secured, at saka partially secured. So, yun na ang makukuha kong net free assets. At alam ko na kapag unsecured liabilities without priority ang pinag-uusapan, dalawang component yon. One is yung mismong nakalagay na without priority, and second, yung galing dun sa partially secured creditors, yung deficiency doon. So I think kung mapanghahawakan mo yon as you go along, it will be a big help for you. Kasi mas mahirap pag you memorize the items na included. But when you understand the concept behind the computation, it will be easier for you. So, meron tayong alternative solution here for your understanding and for your own reading na ito. You can also use this as you go along. But I will not be discussing this alternative solution for now. Let's proceed with illustration 6, the receivership, the journal entry. I think we already have discussed this on our previous illustration. Pasadahan lang natin ng konti. So, binigyan ka. So, si ABC ay nag-liquidate. And dahil nag-liquidate siya, di ba, ang normal process is merong receiver or merong trustee dyan. So, merong relevant information related to your assets, liabilities, at book and realizable values. So, yung assets lang ang nag-change, ang realizable value. Merong daw unrecorded items ng dividend receivable. So, ito asset to. Interest payable, liability, estimated expenses. This is a future expense. This is a supplementary expense. So, requirements. How much is the estimated equity in the opening journal entry in the receiver's books? And how much is the estimated deficiency to unsecured creditors without priority in the statement of affairs? So, di ba, when we discuss on our, I think in discussion video part 2, yung last discussion video, we identify na kapag ibinigay sa isang receiver yung capacity to wind up the affairs of the partnership and one who is responsible in liquidating the affairs of the partnership, you are merely transferring the assets at book values and the liabilities at their book values, di ba? Then any deficiency will be close to, or the balancing figure will be close to estate equity kapag credit at estate deficit kapag debit. So how do we recognize the opening journal entry? Itong, we refer to the book values. So, debit, the assets, 300,000, and then credit, the liabilities, at 320,000. The deficiency will be close to estate deficit dahil yan ay naka-debit. Okay? The balancing figure. Yung etong mga unrecorded items will be recorded separately kasi yun yung rule under a receivership. Itong estimated as administrative expenses will only be recorded when it is actually paid. Okay? Requirement 2. How much is the estimated deficiency to unsecured creditors without priority in the statement of affairs? So, estimated deficiency. How do we compute for the deficiency? Ito yung assets at the realizable value and then the total liabilities. Magkano ba ang assets at realizable value? 250,000. Meron pa bang additional, yung additional assets dyan, yung dividend receivable na 5,000. 255,000 ang total assets mo at realizable value. Ang liabilities mo, 320 plus yung payable mo sa interest, 2,000 plus i-add mo na rin itong administrative expenses, di ba? Kasi babayaran din naman yan. So, 320 plus 2 plus 10 is 332,000. So 255 minus 332 is 77,000 estimated deficiency to unsecured creditors without priority. Okay? Okay, illustration 7. I think I will not be discussing illustration 7 because na-discuss ko na ito on the previous discussion video. Ang logic lang kasi under illustration 7 is the use of the template on computing for your net gain or loss. So pinakita lang niya kung paano natin 'yan gagamitin. 'Di ba? When you are given the items such as this, binigyan ka ng mga ganitong item, yung assets to be realized, assets acquired, assets realized, assets not realized, litong-lito ka na dahil hindi mo alam kung ano ba 'to, i-add ko ba 'to or ibabawas ko ba ito. Remember, ang normal ay tatanungin ka lang naman dyan ng net gain or loss. So, kung net gain or loss lang ang tinatanong sa'yo dyan, you have to familiarize yourself on the computation. So, tingnan mo munang mabuti. Tingnan mo yung items. Dapat, alam mo kung kailan mo siya i-add at ibabawas based on the question. Since the question is the net gain or loss you have to identify whether it is a debit or a credit. Kasi, you take a look at the assets. Ano ang normal balance ng asset? The normal balance of assets is a debit. Remember, kapag ang tinatanong sa'yo is the net gain or loss, tingnan mo mabuti para mas maintindihan mo. The normal balance of assets are debits. So, baka nalilito ka kasi, bakit yung assets realized nandun sa credit, assets not realized nasa credit? So, ganito po ang analysis dyan. Assets to be realized, yan yung asset mo ngayon na hindi pa nabebenta, na gusto mo sanang ibenta kasi nga nagliliquidate ka ng affairs, gusto mong ma-convert into cash yan. So, debit yan kasi yan ay asset pa lang. Assets acquired, debit yan kasi nabili mong asset, di ba? Assets realized, kaya siya naka-credit is because ibinenta mo siya or yan ay naging cash. Ibig sabihin, hindi na yan non-cash. Naibenta na yan at na-realize na, kaya siya naka-credit. Assets not realized, ito yung mga assets na gusto mong ibenta pero hindi pa siya nabenta. So, bakit siya binabawas doon? Because you are computing for the net gain or loss. Diba? You are computing for your net gain or loss kaya binabawas mo yan. Same is true with your liabilities. Ang normal balance niyan ay credit. Kaya nga liabilities to be liquidated, naka-credit pa yan kasi liabilities pa lang yan. Hindi pa yan nababayaran. Then, liabilities assumed, ito yung nadagdag pa doon sa dati mong liabilities. Ngayon, nung na-liquidate na siya, nabayaran mo na siya, ibig sabihin, babawasan mo ang yung liabilities. Liabilities not liquidated, sir, bakit inilalagay pa itong not liquidated? Because you are computing for your net gain or loss. Ang orientation kasi when you are a liquidating entity, itong mga liabilities na hindi mo pa nababayaran are reflected as a loss. Parang ganun. Parang as a loss for you. Same is true with the assets na not realized. Parang ang orientation dyan ay parang loss mo kasi hindi mo siya na-realize. Ganun. Then, the normal supplementary expenses, 25,000. The normal supplementary income is a credit. So, debit credit. So, same procedure for expenses and income. then you will be arriving at your net gain or loss. So kapag gumagamit ka ng T-account, you should be familiar and you should know how it is used. If the debits is greater than the credits using this template ng liquidation affairs, there will be a net loss. In this case, net loss ka ng 1,040,000. Kapag naman baliktad, the credits are greater than the debits, you will have a net gain on this. So, ganun siya. So, requirement B, the ending balance of cash. So, kung ang deficit daw at the end of the period is 870, so ito yun. Liabilities not liquidated, ang sabi, 2,008,000. Ilan ba yung not liquidity? 1,190,000. 1,190,000 minus 870 is 320,000. So, 320,000, kung yun ang total, dahil equal yan, 320, then minus mo yung assets not realized by 220,000, your cash is 100,000. So, ito yung paggamit noong ng basic accounting equation and computing for your ending balance of cash. Okay, let's proceed with the organization. As opposed to corporate liquidation, the organization looks at restructuring or rehabilitating the corporation. Kumbaga, the orientation is to continue. Kasi sa liquidation, the orientation is to terminate the business. While in reorganization, the orientation is to just restructure to rehabilitate the corporation for it to continue. So there are reasons why we reorganize. One is yung buyouts and takeovers, business combinations, reverse acquisition, sale or transfer of subsidiaries, and demergers. Demergers yung this is the opposite of yung merger. Kasi kung nag-merge dati, tapos ngayon maghihiwalay, that can be classified as demergers. C, the formation of a new holding company. D, recapitalization. And E, an insolvent corporation enters into a corporate rehabilitation program. So, more or less, the concept of reorganization is a conceptual question in the CPA board exam and in the review. So, you have to familiarize the concept kasi dati ang tinuturo lang is yung mismong corporate liquidation. But now, the concept of reorganization as opposed to liquidation has been introduced. So, there are types of corporate reorganization. One is group reorganization. Ano bang sinasabi sa group? Ownership within a group of companies changes due to new acquisitions, formation of new holding company, buyouts, takeover, reverse acquisition, disposal of subsidiaries, demerger, and other forms of changes in ownership. Diba? For example, the SM group of companies. So, there are changes within the group of the companies. So, yun yung sinasabing group reorganization. So, pwedeng within the group of companies ni SM, merong there are acquisitions, there are takeovers, or there are disposal of subsidiaries. So, yung mga ganong klaseng reorganization are classified under a group reorganization. Recapitalization refers to the change in capital structure through the replacement of old shares with new shares. So, recapitalization, kaya siya recap dahil yung dating capitalization has been changed or altered. Pwedeng from par to no par or pwedeng no par to par or vice versa. Pwedeng decrease or increase in the par or stated value or pwedeng share split. Yun ay classified na as reorganization under recapitalization. Next, quasi-reorganization. An accounting procedure whereby a financially troubled corporation revalues its assets and liabilities and realigns its equity subject to the provisions of relevant regulations in order to establish a fresh start in accounting sense. So, anong pinagkaiba nito? Ang pinagkaiba lang nito on the other items, kasi itong recap, more on the capital structure dun sa shareholdings sa mga par and no par. The group reorganization concerns the group of companies within a group of companies. The quasi-reorganization, it can be only one corporation changing, revaluing its assets and liabilities para mag-match dun sa equity composition niya. Kumbaga, nire-revalue natin yung assets, tinitingnan natin yung realizable value ng liabilities natin para makita natin kung kumbaga nire-realize mo yung ibang assets para hindi ganoon karami kataas ang iyong debt ratio. Kumbaga ganoon. You look at your own financial account titles and then tinitingnan natin kasi kapag masyadong mataas ang liability component natin, the tendency is we tend not to attract investors kapag masyadong mataas ang ating debt ratio. So pwedeng kaya ang tinitingnan dito, we revalue our asset and then we look at our liabilities para align yung liabilities and yung equity, di ba? The basic accounting equation, asset is equal to liabilities plus equity. Dapat yung composition ng assets, yung assets na mayroon ka, it should be somehow a balance between the liabilities and equity. Or, better, mas marami sana yung galing sa equity than the liabilities. Kasi kung mas hamak 80% or 70% of your assets comes from the debts or the liabilities, there is a possibility not of you not attracting investors kasi puro utang ka pala. There's a possibility na baka maging insolvent ka in the future. So yun yung rationally why we proceed with the quasi reorganization. Next, corporate rehabilitation, a process whereby a financially troubled corporation is administered by another party in order to try to bring back the corporation to its former financial condition. So kung dito sa quasi reorganization, you cure yourself, ikaw mismo ang gumamot sa sarili mo. On corporate rehabilitation, you ask for another party to bring back the corporation to its formal financial condition. So this is governed by the Financial Rehabilitation and Insolvency Act of 2010, the FRIA of 2010. I want to remind you of this FRIA. Kasi itong FRIA na to, this is discussed in the review school and this is asked in the Sipali board exam as conceptual question. So you have to read the FRIA when you have to have read the FRIA before you meet your CPE board exam questions. Bago ka mag-exam, dapat na pasadahan mo itong Financial Rehabilitation and Insolvency Act of 2010 because there is a possibility of you encountering it. Ayaw mo naman magulat on the board exam. So you have to just read the FRIA Act of 2010. Item E, troubled debt restructuring, involves the settlement of obligation at other than the originally agreed method of settlement. It is an instance whereby the creditor, for economic or legal reasons related to the debtor's financial difficulties, grants the debtor concession that would not otherwise be granted in a normal business relationship. So, debtor concession. Nagbibigay ng grace period, pwedeng extended period of payment, yung creditor mo. Kumbaga, inaayos mo yung mga utang mo because you are, malapit ka na kasi eh. Kumbaga, reorganization, after reorganization, mapupunta ka na sa liquidation sana. Pero dahil ayaw mo, you have to find ways or options on you to cure the financial standing of the company. One is troubled debt restructuring. Inaayos mo o kinakausap mo itong mga creditors mo for you to ask for debtor concession, so pwedeng i-waive yung ibang penalties or interest, or pwedeng i-extend yung periods of payment. So mga ganong restructuring agreement. So yun yung sinasabi under the troubled debt restructuring. So I think I have to end the discussion here that the reorganization is a conceptual question in the board exam, while corporate liquidation is more of a computational question in the Sipale. So you just have to read the chapter summary. I think I already have emphasized many of these items. Thank you.